Should the NBA return or should the players not play? Carl Coulanges for the Sports Hit List by the fans for the fans. We are here with my NBA contributors. Coach Womack is in the building. Coach, how you
doing? What's up? I'm doing all right. Day by day, happy to see everybody, man.
Ray Jarvis from the Great Area. Ray, how you doing, bro?
Doing all right, man. Pleasure to be back.
We have the rookie Brandon Falco for the Falco Takeaway. How you doing, Brandon?
What's going on? Thank you for having me.
That's and we have the pastor himself for the Sucker MCs, Mr. Mike Miller himself. Mike, how you doing, bro?
Great, man. And happy to be here, as always, with the fellas, man.
All right, so I'm not going to waste any time. The question on the table, should the NBA come back? We have a lot of chatter on in the media about Kyrie taking the approach as the vice president of the Players Union, saying players should take a stand and not play. And meanwhile, we have LeBron saying he wants to play. So I'm going to start off with Coach, or what we like to call our WOM. WOM, what's the word?
The word, I talked to a couple people actually today, and the word I'm going to take is confusion. And there's subparts. There's disconnect between certain players and what's going on. I actually listened to a Ray's podcast, his presentation, and he was spot on with Kyrie. He's saying the right things, but the messenger, because he's not playing. He was interested in going back, you know, to see if he can rehab with the team. He posed those questions as part of the VP, and then now he's voicing his concern. From what I'm getting is that Kyrie is speaking up for others who feel this way, and that's what he's doing as his job as the vice president. Others came to him, and they knew that if their voices weren't as powerful as his, especially him being one of, I think, the 10 or 11 players whose contract is already guaranteed, and they thought for his vice president position, he should speak on those who are dissenting and thinking there's other options to not going back, not just for social issues, but also, like we talked pre-show, about some of the younger players who are in their big contract years not being taken care of if any freak injury happens to them for the rest of their career, mixing those max deals. So I'm going to say it's confusion right now. Pat Beverly threw a little spice yesterday where he said a lot of people thought that he was saying he's with LeBron, but he actually was saying LeBron don't speak for the whole NBA. If you read his tweet, he's really – that's why he put stay woke. He was saying LeBron said he's playing, but that don't mean all of us are feeling the same way, because if you go look more into his tweets, he's saying I don't know if he should come back. So it's a lot of disconnect, a lot of confusion.
So, Ray, could you elaborate more on your video today and what you were trying to show to the audience?
I just believe that the messenger means well. Kyrie, generally speaking, everything he says to the media means well. The filtering of his message always gets lost because he says one or two things that leaves you scratching your head, you know? And then we already know how the public is. You say one thing and that becomes your stigma for the rest of your career. Started with the flat earth, you left LeBron James, you made decisions that the common man wouldn't make. So people look at him as like, this guy is a weirdo. We see the comments, we hear the comments, we know what it is. So it's difficult for Kyrie to do the right thing for once when his track record says that he might be a little off kilter or aloof. These are the words that are attached to him. And for once, people are not dealing with the facts. You know what I mean? Like, if he's the VP of the players' union, he's not speaking for himself. But before we could even get to that fact, that picture that went viral, we had to go through the washer machine of how bad of a guy Kyrie is, how not trustworthy he is, how much of a person who's selfish and anti-LeBron he is, before we realized, wait a minute, he's speaking for other guys. Then we had a Zoom call and things of that nature. We didn't want to hear about that. We just wanted to kill Kyrie. So if the messenger is a person who doesn't have the equity, as I said in the video, how can the public completely digest that information properly without worrying about indigestion later?
Well said. Brandon, you sent the article out to the panel beforehand, which spoke about, you know, the players should be able to use their platform because they're the only ones who will be on TV at the given point if they do return on July 31st. They can have, I believe Mark Spears wrote the article of how, you know, they can use the platform of being the only sport still playing for social advocacy. What are your thoughts?
Exactly that. So I just want to talk about just social justice. No season doesn't mean the whole racism is going to end. It's not going to magically just end in 2021 anyways. So I don't think like not having a season is going to help the situation whatsoever. playing, I really think, will actually help the situation in terms of hearing your voice. There's not going to be fans in the stadiums, so it's actually a better opportunity for players to speak out and be heard on the biggest stage. Some examples that I thought of and I read in the article. One team could wear a Black Lives Matter shirt to warm up in. Another could wear I Can't Breathe. Another thing is that players aren't getting paid. So if you do end up playing and then you get paid, you get that money, you could use that to donate to your community for the Black Lives Matter, for the I Can't Breathe, anything like that. So that's why I really believe that they should play 100%. And obviously we're so desperate for sports on top of that.
Mike, in your own words, the NBA is fantastic. But in the light of what's going on in America, is it fantastic that should it take a standstill and not play, or should they play?
This is an interesting point because, like everyone else, like you said, the NBA is fantastic, but I'm absolutely with not watching basketball and them not playing. And just, you know, full disclosure, a couple of years ago, we was having a conversation about one NFL athlete deciding he was going to protest, and then everybody started talking about a boycott. Fast forward 4 years, I haven't watched the NFL. So for me, the love of sports doesn't trump what is actually going on in our communities. And so I disagree with this idea that there's more of an impact, because the article Brandon sent was phenomenal, phenomenally written, but what it talked about was symbolism. And so our community has done symbolism already. We've tried that. So LeBron wore an I Can't Breathe shirt. We've all tried the symbolism. And I think what Kyrie is talking about, and particularly what I want to share today, is that our issues within our community, that's why you see the ADOS, our issues in our community go a lot deeper than police brutality. That's just more so a symptom of the larger problem of white supremacy and racial disparities in this country. And so if that means that a player of Kyrie's magnitude, for whatever his background is, him or Dwight Howard, and Dwight Howard said something beautiful in his tweet. He said, if it means no basketball to some degree, and I can have my community in unity, I'll take that any day as the win. And how I'm looking at it is that if they're deciding that they would rather forego because we've never seen NBA players protest in that way. We've never seen them boycott. We have seen them wear t-shirts. We have seen them do interviews. We've seen those things before. And just one example is when it was found out about Donald Sterling, they didn't decide they were going to wear t-shirts and ask for money or anything. They had already decided they were going to boycott. Stephen Curry has come out and admitted that. LeBron and Chris Paul, they were going to boycott. So to me, there is a tremendous power if these athletes who have such a notoriety decide that they are not going to play until, because they didn't say, and Kyrie's not given a date, and we can talk about that more, but yeah, so I'm in favor of it 100% if they decide they don't want to play.
Go ahead, Coach.
Paul, I just wanted to, before we move on, two of the biggest impacts, I think, in terms of entertainment and sports and racial divide, Muhammad Ali, who some say is the GOAT in terms of social activism. And in entertainment, people don't remember the movie Ray. I know a lot of people think it's Jamie Foxx, but Ray Charles was very influential in shutting down pretty much that Chitlin circuit. And he didn't play in Georgia because of the racial inequalities. Now, we could have said the same thing. No, Ray, if you play the biggest halls in Georgia, you can finish your concert and you can say everything that you feel bad about and you got so many people watching. Muhammad Ali, if you remain the champion, after every fight, you have all the press there to talk to you about what's going on in the country and racial injustices, and you can use that platform in order to showcase why just not fight. It's the same thing. So I kind of lean to what Mike can say, that for so many years, they've told us how to boycott. They've told us what to do. If the players decide to play, I'm with them. If the players vote and the VPs, they vote and they say as a collective union, we are going to play, I'm with them. But don't tell them what to do. Let them decide that on their own. Let them get together. Let them have a vote. Let them talk amongst themselves. And then they make a decision on what statement they want to make. I think everybody's saying you can't do this, you can't do that. You're putting them in a box, and that's when Kyrie said, you're not going to tell us what to do. You're not going to tell us how to protest.
Ray, do you believe this causes tension among the league? Because you have a set players who say, okay, I'm ready to play as long as we have COVID restrictions and we're getting tested. And then you have a set of players who don't feel comfortable to play. So is that going to create a tension among the NBA players?
I mean, the tension is inherent because beyond not playing or playing, there's money. So for every supermax player or max player, there's a player who's been living above his means by the NBA standards of living above their means because they're making still like $800,000, but they're still living check to check. So they need that next check to start, you know, paying those bills, paying off that Bentley or whatever car they drive in, mm-hmm. paying off an old bar tab or whatever the case may be. Those debt collectors are calling. So mm-hmm. there's going to be tension because people need that chicken. The next issue is with that article, and this is what we have to understand, especially Brandon, not being a black man, is that race relations in America, there is no linear option. It's so combustible that article is brilliant, 100%. Yeah, that is a great idea. But for all the symbolism, there's another group of people who want to go outside and wild out because they feel oppressed. So basketball is kind of a microcosm of America right now. There's a group of people who want to go outside, and there's a group of people who want to go forward and take other routes. There is no right way to get this done.
So piggyback on that, in terms of the players not getting paid, that is a huge part because I believe it's three quarters of their paycheck has to go back to the owners. Then the owners have to give that to TV networks. So they're losing a ton of money. And like you said, as much money as they do have, they're still living paycheck to paycheck. And I don't know why we don't feel like we could multitask. I understand there's an issue, but you could still do both. A guy like LeBron James, who's as vocal as anybody, I don't think just because he's in the playoffs is going to stop talking about this issue. That's really like my biggest problem with it. But I think we should play. Guys can multitask. And I still feel like another thing that I thought of like before this Zoom edition, players could get up and talk about before a game. I have a 4-minute little speech about what it means to be a black man, what they went through in their entire life, what's hurt them in their life growing up, what were their difficulties. That's just something I thought of. There's probably a bunch of other ideas to address this issue. Have a moment of silence before games. There's still always ways where you could still express your opinion by playing. And I feel like with no fans in the stadiums, the TV ratings are going to be through the roof because we're all so desperate for sports. Voices are going to be heard more by playing games than sitting out. Doesn't guarantee that racism ends. There's no guarantee, and this doesn't mean that it's going to end in 2021. So what you're telling me is if there's still racism next year, then you have to boycott next season as well?
Yes. Yes. I'm literally saying that at some point, life is bigger than watching a sport. And that is essentially what we have reached in this country in critical mass, is we have realized that what goes on in our community since the first slave comes in 1619 is a systemic issue for 400 years. And right now is not the time to still be thinking about, are we desperate for basketball? And so let me just give you some facts for everybody watching, just so we can understand how deep this goes. Because we talk about George Floyd and where he was, but we forget that he grew up in a community in Houston that had almost four times the poverty rate. When we talk about what's happened to our community, particularly the ADOS community, also known as African American, when we talk about racism, we're talking about a wealth level, right? So if you talk about the median black household has $1,700 in wealth without depreciating assets. The median white household has $170,000. Of the 20 million black families, right? 20 million black families, there's only 350,000 millionaires, and 50% of them are worth 1 million. If you convert that to 13 million white households with millionaires, there's 13 million of them, and over 50% of them have more than one million. So we're basically a poor group. And what you're seeing now is what Attorney Antonio Moore called the decadent veil. What the decadent veil is athletes and celebrities masking the poverty and the deprivation and that is in our community. So you have people like LeBron James and everyone else, and they mask the poverty. So when you see LeBron, you say, what are you guys fighting for? Why do you need reparations? Why are you talking about racism? Look, there's a black millionaire right there. Look, another black millionaire, forgetting that most of us are poor. Most of our community is poor. If you did a quick Google of the worst cities to live in, you will find that most of those cities are black cities. For example, if you look at where I just came from in Michigan, Niles Benton Harbor, Michigan, the poverty rate for black people is 16.7%. The poverty rate for white people in that same community is 6%. We are talking about literally our house is on fire. And when our house is on fire, the question isn't, can we watch basketball? The question is, who's gonna get the buckets of water? And that is what Kyrie is basically saying, is that now is the time to get the buckets of water. The house is on fire, we have priorities. And really quick with multitasking. Multitasking is a myth. Yes, sometimes you, especially with complex issues, multitasking, you can try to do it, but you shouldn't drive and text. Because it's dangerous. You also could do protests and play basketball, but you won't give 100% of your energy when you're doing something else. This may be the time where you say, you know what? Basketball will take a back seat until things have changed.
Coach, as a player, how hard is it, do you believe, for a player to make that decision to either sit and not play and risk your career for what you believe in, or decide, you know what, I'm going to go against the grain and say, I'm going to play? And if you've ever had to make a decision like that in your career, please speak on it.
I mean, it was a time in Europe one time where I didn't get paid and we were in the playoffs, and I just told the owner I'm not playing unless they pay me. I showed up to practice with jeans on and I said, if I don't get my 2 month salary before, I'm not going to play in the playoffs. But that was for money. I think for me, it happened 2 weeks ago. You know, I'm very careful on social media with what I post. I rarely get political. I usually post a lot about, you know, my team and my sports and my family. And two or three nights after the George Floyd incident, I was angry. And I knew that my anger could possibly cost me different coaches in the country who might want to hire me at a higher level, or different, you know, if I want to move to the NBA, which I do have friends in NBA coaching, an owner may see something that I post. You know, I'm a big-time Knicks fan, and I basically disowned the Knicks for their statement that they made in regards to social injustice, which can hurt me, because what if I want to work for the Knicks one day? But at a time, you got to make a decision on what's right or wrong. And you know, I just had to make a decision and say, this is what I stand by, and if nobody wants to hire me for this, or nobody wants to hire me for that, for speaking on my truth, then you're not just going to hire me. So, you know, the players... That's why I said it's tough with Kyrie, because he's not playing. It's tough right. with Kyrie. We got to stick to that point, because he's the one whose face is posted on this whole movement right now.
Right.
You know, if it was Donovan Mitchell coming out and saying it, we wouldn't be having this conversation. What if LeBron James yesterday came out and said, you know what, guys, it's social injustice. I'm not playing. I don't right. want to play. Nobody would be like, we need basketball. They'd be like, yo, we riding with LeBron. LeBron said, yep. we not playing, then we not playing. It's the messenger right now. So, you know, it's the same thing. If LeBron said it, if Chris Paul said it, you know, guys will be rallying behind them a little bit differently than they are Kyrie Irving. But that's okay. Sometimes in history, history shows us that the leaders are the people we least expect, you know, who know mm-hmm. there's a lot of people who made their impact on historic events, and we did not know who they were before they took a stance. And who knows, 5 years from now, we may be looking at this moment, even if they play, and people may be like, you know what? Kyrie was right. He was mm-hmm. right, because I'm telling you, if we play, I swear to you, you can say whatever you want. Like, and Brandon, I just want to say this. I won't be taking up too much time. I really respect you coming on here with a different point of view, because it's tough. It's tough, especially as a non-minority person. It is tough and to come in with a different point of view. And, you know, it's kind of like we're attacking you, but we're not. We're just giving you our thoughts. So I just wanted to commend you on that before I continue with this next line, my last line. But what you said, and this could be a learning point for you and for others. You said, like, you can give a little speech before the game. You can give a little interview before, after the game. Like, now it's not the movement anymore. It's after. It's before. It's the appetizer before the main meal, or it's the dessert. What's the main meal? The main meal would be basketball, and we go back to basketball, where the main meal should not be basketball right now. The main meal should be how are we going to change what's happening in our country, because I tell you this, Brandon, if anyone from the sports hit list on this group or any of your close friends ended up dead due to some injustice, you would not want to see any sports. You would be right in the front lines fighting for what you believe in. And I think if you think of it like that, you kind of understand where some of these players come from.
I respect it.
Ray Jarvis, how does this play out? Do they play or do they not play? Your gut feeling.
I think money talks. Y'all know me already. If you don't know me, anyone watching this right now, I always say follow the money. At the end of the day, money talks. There's too many contracts that have been signed. It's too much revenue that's already been lost. So at some point or the other, they're gonna play. My concern is because of the microwave era, that once the playoffs start to get rampant and the new narratives come out, people will forget about what's going on. I did say earlier on my clip that I want to see what happens, more or less because I want to see if people can truly multitask, to Brandon's point. We got to see it because it's going to happen. But I fear the worst, I'll be honest.
Mike, do they play or do they not play?
Hell, they'll probably play. It's like Ray said, you're going to follow the money, and the money's involved, and personal accolades and agendas are in play here. So not to say it's just LeBron. It could be anyone that personally feels a stake in this, and then you have the lower-level players that want to that you know are living, because I think Kyrie said something like it's 80%. No, C.J. McCollum was on a show, I think, last year and talked about. And they asked him how many players live check to check. He said at least 80% of the league lives check to check. So a lot of them are financially going to want to play. But, you know, like everything else, there's a sacrifice that comes with change. And so some players are willing to make that sacrifice. Others won't. But I think ultimately, Patrick Beverley's point was it not just that, you know, LeBron, everybody don't speak for LeBron, but he's kind of saying, like, if LeBron says it's going to happen, then the league is going to try to push for LeBron to make it happen. It's the same thing with what Max saying in the reverse. If LeBron says we ain't playing, then it's not going to happen. And that's why, but like I said, with the Donald Sterling example, LeBron was one of the people that was going to protest. And he was one of the people that was going to boycott. When you have the biggest player in the league saying, I'm not standing up for this, I'm not taking this, then things happen. So I think with him pushing it, with Chris Paul pushing it, I think they'll most likely play.
Brandon, do they play or do they not play?
I wish I knew the answer. Obviously, I'm hoping that they play, but I honestly don't think so because there's just too many things going on. I feel like just more and more people are going to come out with new things. The non-title contenders are saying the coronavirus, that's why they don't want to play. I don't believe that's for another day. And then the social justice issue, I just think more players are just going to keep coming up with reasons why they don't want to play, and they'd rather pursue this issue, and they think that's more important. I just don't necessarily agree that the NBA players are the only people who could fix this issue. There's so many people in the news, politicians, other citizens around the world focusing on this issue. And it's not just NBA players that are going to fix this issue. So I honestly don't think they play, but I'm hoping they do. Wong probably has the best answer for that. He probably knows more than all of us.
Whoa,
they playing.
Whoa.
They playing.
They playing?
they playing. I'm not even going to hold you. I was talking to an NBA person last night. Actually, it was at my house, and they are playing. Yeah, but here's the thing, though. Here's the thing, and this is if I could get out to Kyrie and reach out to him, I will, and just or anybody, and say, if you're not playing, Kyrie, I want to see you step up. I want to see you get the players who are not playing, because there's a lot of players who are not involved in the playoffs right now. There are a lot of legends who have a lot of equity in terms of their personal beliefs and what they went through in their careers, and they hold a lot of weight in their communities. If you're not playing, let me see you get band a group together, and let me see you go to the forefront of this issue and champion our struggle and what we are dealing with right now as someone who's not having to play. That's where I think you have to meet, you know, in the middle. Obviously, you voice your opinion. If they say we got to play, they're going to play, but I want to see him step up.
That's the best of both worlds. That's a great point I didn't even think of. There's still groups of players, a bunch of players who aren't going to be playing this season, and teams are going to go home within 8 games. So that's a great point. We could still play basketball and other guys could prioritize their time to help this movement. So actually, I do believe they should play, and that's a great point that I didn't think of.
Well, gentlemen, thank you for joining me here on the Sports Hit List by the fans and for the fans. Ray, you want to give your podcast a quick shout out?
Yeah, you already know Gray Area, Rat Round Table, everyone watching this. There's an underlying issue with the NBA versus LeBron James. Pay attention to everything you're reading and what you're hearing. A lot of people not feeling LeBron right now, and it's leaking out piece by piece.
And Brandon, you want to give a shout out to your podcast as well?
Yeah, so you can find me on Instagram, DeFalco Takeaway. I post daily sports videos of myself, or I have a peer join me to discuss any sports topics I'd like to discuss. If you ever have any discussion you'd like to join with me, please let me know. Debate me, comment. I'll always give you my rebuttal. Thanks again for tuning in.
All right. Again, thank you for watching the Sports Hit List by the fans for the fans. Please make sure you check out our content on social media. Like, share, comment, subscribe. We are coming to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network on Wednesday starting at 4 o'clock. You could log on to their website and their social media platforms to listen to us. Gentlemen, it's a pleasure as always. Thank you for joining me. I hope everyone is staying safe out there. I love you guys. You guys be well, and I'll speak to you guys soon on the next Zoom.
Yes, sir. See you.